Well, so we're speaking the subject of second cycle education. And we know just over the weekend, the whole policy initiative has campaigned on, indeed, that have been the campaign promise since 2008 of Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo, who is now President Akufo-Addo of our republic, has seemed to come to some pedestal or some fruition with the announcement of what really a free SHS would be like. But of course, we need to ask questions whether everything free would also connote quality. And let me just take you through the Daily Graphic. You get to the Daily Graphic on page 3 of the paper, and the president was a keynote speaker or the guest speaker at the Kwapeman 60th anniversary celebrations. And he said, by free SHS, we mean that in addition to tuition, which is already free, there will be no admission fees, no library fees, no science center fees, no computer fees, no utility fees, no laboratory fees, etc., etc. There will be free textbooks, free boarding and free meals for both boarders and day students, and all that will be free. Well, we have to get into the conversation. We'll be joined on the line by Michael Nsoa, is a former Director General for the Ghana Education Service, and also we'll try as much as possible to get other known educationists on the ground. But we also have the experts and the think tanks who tend to do a lot more work with civil society, and we have in the studio to help us do the conversation, Ekem Reginald Amonu Latson. He's Executive Director of a charity called UNIDPM, and I'll ask him to tell me what the whole acronym means. But it's an NGO. They're doing so much work in education and building the structure of education at the grassroots level. And I have Ekem in the studio. Ekem, a very good morning to you.
Morning. Good morning.
The organization, what does it mean? UNID.
UNIDPM. It actually took me a while to even roll it off like that. So understandable.
Okay.
But essentially, it is the United Network for Integrated Development Planning and Management. The whole idea of the NGO is that any one particular issue does not exist in isolation of itself. I am sort of influenced by a very good book called Consilience, where the idea is that there is a unity of knowledge, and that anything that you seek to do, it doesn't basically exist in isolation of itself. So we seek to do an integrated approach to development, knowing that one issue comes along with everything else along its coattail. So you have to sort of take it in its entirety rather than just be myopic.
And I was reading a couple of things from your NGO. You don't necessarily have to focus on education, but
yes,
basically
we also do work in the built environment. Mm. I'm a town planner by training, but I have a lot of experience in education. So we also address things dealing with the built environment, with human settlement planning, town planning. So we're also working on some other issues on that end as well.
But relatedly, mm-hmm. let's yes. speak on the subject of education. I'm sure you may have had great experiences with best practices,
not only
on the continent, but around the world.
Yes, yes, yes.
When it comes to education in a developing country
yes.
like ours,
mm-hmm.
Ideally, what should it be structured on in terms of perhaps funding, the quality, content, and output?
I mean, I think for me, the most important thing is access, first of all, equal access to education, so that everybody has an equal opportunity. If you don't give people the ability to participate, then you are sort of being discriminatory. So I think the most important thing, most of all, is access. Beyond access, then you have to then worry about the issue of quantity, because quantity could rarely compromise quality. And anything that is not of quality, of requisite quality, it might not even be necessary to exist, because it's not doing what it's supposed to do. Uh-huh. So I believe that that is the once you have the access, then you have to slide between quality and quantity to make sure that your progress is facile, that you are doing what you need to get done to move things forward. So there's always that compromise between the two. Some people say that the average net enrollment rate basically is the automatic gear changer when it comes to moving things ahead, because even when you make access available, people still don't enroll their children. So let's say for a particular cohort of academic level, a child that is maybe 10 years old is supposed to be in a certain grade, but the people who are actually enrolling in that grade are less than the population indicates that they are. So some people say that even with this NPP policy is that though they make the argument about the quantity, which will compromise quality, some people also say that the net enrollment rate might also then be an automatic sort of stop valve to there being a threat to quantity, because not a lot of people are enrolling. So one must weigh all those arguments when one discusses or judges or whatever the issue.
If you read and widely published literature on the continent, mm-hmm. for example, Egypt has got a literacy rate of about 89%.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it's a more developed country than ours, mm-hmm. of course, if mm-hmm. you look at their structure.
Structure, yeah, okay.
Now, at the end of the day, you come to sub-Saharan Africa, mm-hmm. and we're in the belt of the ranges at which we are. But
yes,
we
yes.
also know that we want to create a lot more access.
Yes.
Okay. So how then does this policy create mm-hmm. the access whilst at the same time thinking of quality?
Well, first of all, I believe that the idea is that when you bring people in, you give them a good opportunity. That's the first thing. Now, of course, it behooves the student and the parents to do their end of the bargain, as it also behooves the teachers to do the same. We have challenges on both those levels. And parents leave the device of their childhoods, of their children's welfare to themselves. So they have the children, but they don't really undertake the responsibility of making sure that they're educated well. At the same time, you have teachers that might be truant, or they are not in the profession for which they would like to be in, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So all these things sort of mitigate the quality of education. But I believe that so long as you can make sure that the people who want to go to school and the people who are able to excel in school are given a fair opportunity to do that. So I think that is the bottom line when it comes to education policy for the people who it will benefit. Because you also have another catch-22, is that when you educate all these people and they don't find work to do, then you create a disaffected class who then could be, you know, become sort of like a noose around your neck economically. So that's another thing that one has to also think about. But I believe that the policy has a right heart. One should also then wonder if it has a right head.
Meaning
that what needs to be in place to get things done properly are done properly. Because one may say, I love you, and it comes from the heart. But if one is not able to meet the responsibilities of one's love to another, then one would say that, okay, well, you promised me this, but you didn't deliver. And you could then accuse that person of not thinking through what they said they were going to promise you. So I think that's the challenges. And of course, the detractors would say one thing or the other. The politicians who promised something would try to give you all the excuses that they can. So I think all in all, the policy is something that I think the country should welcome. I think the country should encourage, but also the country should be vigilant to make sure that whatever needs to happen, happens. I believe that we also make the distinction, or we don't make the distinction, that all education doesn't necessarily need to happen in a classroom. I believe that we should go to other modules of education whereby it's not simply a child sitting in a classroom receiving a lecture from a teacher. Because I even have a problem with the lecture format of education. I believe it doesn't really teach one anything. It gives you the capacity to gain knowledge. And I've always said that you can always gain knowledge even if you're 80 years old. If you don't know how to process and apply it, it's practically worthless on some level, because then you're just regurgitating what?
Mm-hmm.
So I believe that the government policy should focus on basically make sure that there is practical application, mm-hmm. and there's also critical processing, more so than just saying that we will give children an education and then it defaults to a lecture format, etc., etc., etc.
Well, we've practiced this before, haven't we?
Well, yes, one can argue that, yes.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. So in that, if we look at hindsight, would you say that doing a replication of this in the current times is the best way to go? Doing en masse, perhaps shifting of people through certain blocks of the educational ladder and thinking that you get the best out of them?
Well, yeah, I mean, the history or our past doesn't really suggest that. The quality has gotten better. People always say that, you know, when I was in school in the 70s and 80s, people were saying that quality was wonderful, it was great. My parents' generation, when they were in secondary school, were saying that theirs was even better. The argument that one always makes, the average citizen that you come across, says that when in the 80s there was a massive enrollment of education, that's when some argue that, you know, quality tanked. Now, one cannot also make the argument that those people that didn't have a right to access to education, they had a right to access to education.
Yes, they do.
The problem is that where there was a heart to help them, the head was not there to make sure that they met those goals. So one argues that, okay, from going from a primary to secondary, lower from 1 to 5 and then lower 6, and now changing it to this JHS, SHS model, which has also shifted between a 4-year and a 3-year SHS, is all part of the confusion that, you know, and people have towards the way we do education. I believe that the quantity should be approached very cautiously, and I think as much as possible that the focus should be on quality even before quantity. So even let's say you're walking on 2 steps, the first step should always be quality before you bring in the quantity. Not to say that quantity shouldn't happen, because people have a right to education. All I'm saying is that part of the problem is that even after you raise the quality, I mean raise the quantity, when you don't do things like make sure that children are having a good education beyond, I would say, this lecture format, true and poor, then you are just setting up yourself or another government or the country for some disappointment down the line. And I believe that there are other ways to look at the way in which we improve quality besides putting everybody in the classroom to suffer the, in my opinion, the staleness of a lecture format sort of education, where you get a book, the teacher writes things on the board, you write the things in your book, you go and memorize it, and then you pour it out. But then these same people, when they finish education and they, let's say, are hired by the banks or whomever else, you give them an assignment and they can't perform it because they have not had the opportunity to be critical thinkers about one thing or the other. So then they are certified, I mean, they are basically certified in something, but they don't have any acumen to sort of...
If you look at the countries that practice free education, I mean, they have the right resources to support it. And we know that some of the leading advanced countries do that for public education.
Yes, yes, yes.
But the production or the level of output, I think is commensurate to the kind of funding or the quantity of funding that is put in there.
Well, I mean, some people can argue, I mean, America is having this wonderful battle, I would say. They have a free education system. The average Ghanaian would think it's a superior system. But they have a lot of challenges with their system, a lot of them. That is why there is this strong argument that schools need to be given choice. I mean, the schools need to give parents choice so that if they believe that the public system is not giving them what they want, they can go to a private charter school or what have you. So that argument is made all the time, consistently, consistently, consistently. And there also, even though they give children the room to maneuver, and they do that on some level to maneuver intellectually, they, one may argue that they also don't give them the room, they give them too much room to maneuver emotionally. So then you have this sort of schism between those two issues, the emotional maturity of these children and also the intellectual and growth. And these things sort of end up in, some would argue that it's a system that is not as promising as one may think.
Perhaps for their environment.
Yes, exactly. And on the other level, you on another scale, you have what has happened in, let's say, in South Korea and China, where they have this rigorous examination system, and although I don't know quite sure their mode of pedagogy, how do they teach the children the subject? So every single system has some challenges. In our system, where the citizens have a meager existence relative to, let's say, a developed country, I believe that access should always be an important part of education policy. Even though we cannot afford it, I think there needs to be a way to afford it. But I believe that the best way to afford it is to make sure that it's not simply an issue of putting children in a classroom. I believe there are many other ways to teach, especially children beyond the basic level. That doesn't need to happen the way it happens in these days. One can also then say on another level that, well, we don't have the infrastructure to do that. We don't have internet access. We don't have one thing or the other to make sure that those things can happen. But I think that there has to be ways where we keep keen attention on economies of scale. For example, I believe that where there needs to be labs for science students, I don't think there needs to be a lab in every single school. I think you can put a lab in a regional center and have children come to it from, so that one lab to the state of art process.
Well, in Ghana, they have what we call the science resource centers.
Yes,
and that's what they try to do.
Yes.
They try to do with the system. It doesn't work very well, though, because of the size of the schools in terms of the populations, etc.
Sure.
We have one bigger lab, perhaps they can co-share.
Yes, exactly.
That's what you're talking
about. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But if we have to get to the point where we're already witnessing huge expenditure or dent in budgetary terms.
Yes.
As far as funding of education, public funding of education is, where we can't pay enough the teachers, we don't get them well motivated. But then we jump onto a policy of making it free.
Yes.
Doesn't it then affect perhaps the quality of teaching that is likely to be?
Well, I'm not sure the quality of teaching or education is simply due to the fact that we can't pay teachers well. Because I believe that part of the problem is that we have, some even argue that the teachers that are there are not motivated even if they were given money, or they are ill-equipped even if they were given more money. So I don't believe that motivating the teachers is the sole factor that is compromising quality. So I believe that one should then think of beyond the teacher, because I honestly believe that the vast majority of what a child learns, honestly speaking, I don't believe it comes solely from the teacher. I believe that the role of the teacher should be more not to give you information that is written on the board and you say, okay, what is in the book you put on the board, and then you just tell the child to repeat it, you know, but rather what the child comes across in the book should be processed by the teacher in the classroom. So it's not about taking notes in the classroom, it's about having a discussion about what is in the book, you see. But rather, I venture to assert that the average teacher takes the book, puts it on the board,
and it's a
they take the notes, the exam comes, the chew and pour.
So it's just a replication.
Yes, it's just a, it's like a mouse in a
wheel. It doesn't make the ordinary student think.
Exactly. So that is where I'm saying that you can teach a child well with meager resources. I don't believe that's really the issue in terms of pain. Because after all, some argue that part of our problem in Ghana is that we have a bloated governmental and bureaucracy. It's too big, it's too fat, and it's too heavy, and it doesn't carry its own weight in terms of the graduates that it graduates out of the system.
If this has to be instituted, and we're told the president is saying it will start from the next academic year.
Yes.
And that will be by the close of the year or before the close of the year, I guess the beginning of the last quarter of the year.
Yes, okay.
It means that students and their parents or their guardians would be looking forward to such free incentives.
Yes.
Okay. What will happen if we have the influx of a lot more people within the secondary schools, or perhaps in those institutions, mm-hmm. and then we don't have enough to cater for them?
Yeah, well, that's with the sad fact of implementation. Ghana, a lot of countries have challenges with implementation. Even Obamacare had implementation problems. And when it happened, the site crashed or whatever else. But I've heard a lot in the field that from educators is that part of the problem with the promise of free education is that parents now believe that they should step back. Everything now is in the hands of the government. Uh-huh. So I think that is where the apathy of parents, I would venture to say, will increase. And that might even sort of retard or slow down what the government is hoping to achieve. So how one addresses the issue of parental apathy, I think somehow needs to also be addressed. So I don't believe that totally the education should be free. That I think there should be some point of parental participation in the costs of giving their children an education. And besides, there's another argument that is being made that the rich kid will always find a means to get an education, so they don't need the assistance. Uh-huh. So then it's the poorer people who need their assistance. So maybe you could graduate it. How you would do that, that's another minefield. But to say that a child with better resources might not maybe, let's say, get free food, I'm not saying that should be the policy. All I'm saying is that as per example, one could discuss ways in which there's a graduated participation by the parents in the process based on the child's family's welfare, income. Uh-huh.
But in many countries, they try to do this.
Yes, they've tried that. Yes, that's true.
And there are countries all over, in Latin America, in the Far East, etc.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to Africa,
yes,
we are constrained by resources, or at least that's what we're told, even though we have huge budgetary expenditures each year.
Sure,
the allocation and the monitoring and evaluation of such resources are not adequately done.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not as if it's going to be different in Ghana.
Yes.
How does that pose a challenge in itself?
Well, I mean, the challenge is that you have... the challenge is to make sure that whatever you undertake with the children's education produces robust graduates. That's the challenge, bottom line. And if you don't achieve that, then it's money not well spent. It becomes... you have basically a series of white elephants walking around with nothing to do with their time or their education. So I believe that is the major challenge of any... So I think there needs to be a striving towards efficiency. I'm saying that part of the problem with the educational system is that it's not efficient. So then you have a big, huge... bloated bureaucracy, you have a lot of students going through, not really getting quality education.
Just being shifted,
exactly. And I've always said, and like I said earlier, the issue of providing a child with knowledge is not as important as giving the child the acumen to process whatever knowledge they come across. That is more important. Uh-huh. So when they're able to critically think through what they need to get done, it's a much better way to approach one of the needed issues that deals with education.
All right, so we have been hearing from other institutions that perhaps are very much related to second cycle education. And the National Association of Graduate Teachers, they've lauded government's free senior high school policy, as announced by President Akufo-Addo over the weekend, and this notwithstanding, NAGRAD President Christian Adaipoku says government must work to prevent challenges that could disturb implementation of the policy.
If government can go ahead and finance it, then I think it's free. And it's very good for us if all these things can be made free for our students. Yeah, the experience we have had over the years is the fact that always we pronounce things to be free, but at the end of it all, they end up creating more problems for the system, because funds that are supposed to be released on time for execution of some of these things are normally not released. And when they delay, they distract the academic system. And so that is one issue that I will advise the government on, that if you have taken it upon yourself that these things are going to be free, which I think is very good, then we must do it well, finance it well, and then financing must be timely. That's the first aspect of it. Secondly, we also, as an association, want to plead with government that they should not allow it to stick to only senior high schools, because the basis is also very important. And so the junior high schools should not be forgotten. Such policies must also be extended fully to the junior high schools. We don't want a situation where we will say it by mouth, and then when it comes to the implementation, it makes matters worse. So we have seen it over the years when promises are made. Capitation grant is there. It's supposed to be given at the beginning of the term, but sometimes 3 terms are in arrears before government decides to pay one. That becomes a problem, because the moment school is going to reopen, every material, every resource that is needed must be available to the school before school reopens. But I don't want a situation where schools reopen and close before funds are released. That is where our problem lies. So it is one thing saying that I'll do it. If government is committed to doing it, they should do it and do it well. If they cannot, then they should allow parents to pay and get quality.
All right.
And that's the NAT precedent. And, they have a great interest in how we make sure we implement this. And NAGRAT is very instrumental in making sure that when it comes to teaching and learning at a second cycle level, they are very much instrumental or have a hands-on approach to it. But how do we make sure that for all the things that we have to do, we have to perhaps learn from the best practice? How do we learn from the best practice?
Well, that one I can't say, because I mean, I don't know the full realm of what is out there and where to go look for it. I do believe that one of the things that needs to happen with public education is that there needs to be robust education, robust competition from the private sector. So I believe that as much as they give parents public education, like the gentleman said, they need to make sure that it doesn't tell the parents that they need to not
have,
worry,
have hands off.
There you go. And I believe that if there is a process whereby a child or a parent can say that the money that you were supposedly spending on my public school, can I take it and go to a private school? That is the issue that is even actually boiling up in the U.S., that charter system. Well, if there's, and I understand that the head is about $215 per year, if not per term, I'm not sure, I can't remember where I read it, in terms of the span of time, but it's about $215, $250 or so. Maybe a parent can say that, give me a chit, give me a voucher, and I can take it to a private school. So as much as, let's say, they might be putting money into the public schools, I think government should also find a policy to make sure that they can encourage the private schools, much as it has happened with the tertiary institutions. And I believe that one sector of our social economy that should be encouraged to do that are the churches. As much, or the religious institutions, as much as they've gone into Valley View and Methodist University, I don't see why they don't do that also on the secondary level, more so on the secondary level, maybe give them some sort of incentives to do that. And I also argue that it should even start from the primary kindergarten level, because the false start is what has backed up to over there. And so on some level, I believe that government should look way ahead and say, these people, we will help them. But the ones we can really help are the ones here. And then from one graduating class to another, in the next 12 to 20 years, those will be the model set of graduates that the economy will need come a certain time in the history of.
And heading another think tank is Dr. Prince Ama. He's the executive director for the Institute for Education. They used to be known as VIAM Africa. A very good morning to you, Dr. Prince Ama. Good morning, Dr. Prince Ama.
Well, I'm having difficulties in hearing you. Can you raise up your voice a bit?
Okay, can you hear me now, Dr. Prinsama?
Yes, okay. I can hear you now.
What do you make of the formal announcement now by government that the next academic year beginning will see the full implementation of the free SHS policy? And indeed, if you look at the line items that will be free, it's almost as if everything is free for going to school at the second cycle level.
Well, I have, thank you very much, and good morning to your cherished viewers. I have always argued that in terms of first policy interventions, we have to look at issues of equity. Now, as this policy seems to portray, is a blanket support for everyone. What issue do we intend to address? I mean, what is the policy development objective? Are we expanding access to secondary school to everyone under the assumption that everybody cannot pay and therefore we must provide funding for them? And I don't think that is the argument. Our problem as we speak is a disparity within the system in terms of people from disadvantaged backgrounds and people from advantaged backgrounds who are having access to secondary education. Now, available data suggests that, for example, in the BEC exams, roughly 50% are able to make it to senior secondary school. There are two problems here. One of them has to do with physical infrastructure, what we call physical assets. The other has to do with what I describe as policy imperative or systemic imperative. The physical infrastructure is the fact that we don't even have the facilities to accommodate everybody if we want to open up senior secondary school to everyone. And so the previous government attempt to establish or construct more senior secondary school helps in this direction. And I have heard the president, His Excellency Nanado, in the last general election campaigning that he was going to continue with the 200 secondary school and add boarding facilities. So we need to address the assets from physical infrastructure. And then we come to the policy issue. BECE has become an abattoir. It is one of the major impediments to access to senior secondary school. The people making up of passing BECE and going to senior secondary school, very often, a lot of them are coming from the affluent background. A lot of them come from the private schools that do very well. And these guys find themselves in the best schools in Ghana that we can find ourselves in. The large proportion of our young people from the villages, from the deprived districts, from the rural areas, are not having access to quality senior secondary school. Let me give you some interesting statistics. In the Upper East region alone, only 11% of BECE candidates are able to pass and go to secondary school. In the Northern region, only 22% are able to pass to go to secondary school. In the Upper West region, only 11% are able to make it. So our policy objective has to be the issue of addressing the inequity and inequality and disparities to access to secondary education. Now let me come to the government policy intention of partially, and this is not full free SHS, it's partial funding of SHS students. And why am I saying partial funding? If you take the fee component for last year, for example, the fee component for last year, for example, the boarders are paying roughly 1,000 Ghana Cedi plus. The day students are paying 610 plus. Now, if you take the boarders alone, as we speak, the fee component that the president has announced, the fee component in terms of no admission fee, no library fee, and then no utility fee, all these fee components, together with textbooks and boarding fees and meals, all these components constitute 52% of the fee component in the senior high school burden as students bear. So there is also an element of 48% of these money that still have to be paid by the parents. You know, in terms of in terms of PTA dues, in terms of incentive packages, in terms of school clothes, house, dress, school uniforms, all of these will not be taken care of by the government. It therefore suggests that parents will still pay roughly 48% of the funding. That is just a bit higher or more higher or a bit a higher step from what the previous government attempted to do by paying a certain proportion of it. So we are saying that if the government wants to absorb 52% roughly, which amounts to about 553 Ghana cedis, using the 2016-2017 figures, we must move ahead to the people in the district, deprived districts, very disadvantaged backgrounds, using mean testing, and pay the other 48% for them. That would have been completely free SHS for those people, and probably partially free SHS
but Dr. Ma,
for the others.
Can we be in a position to say we can do all these things, 100% implementation of free SHS, not taking cognizance of other indicators within the economy which could make it possible for a policy like this to become fruitful or come to fruition in any way?
Yes, it is for this reason that we are of the opinion that we don't have to spend blanket funding, you know, wholesale funding. We don't have to engage in wholesale funding of senior high school. We need to do mean testing. Ministry of Education has been doing mean testing to identify people for scholarship, to identify people for specific interventions. The Ministry of Manpower has got a mean testing protocol. We have gone to World Bank with this mean testing, and we've got funding for them. So that's why we're saying that, look, there are some people, I don't want to mention it, but if I had my son in the senior high school, I can afford to pay for senior high school. And I know there are others who could afford. So why don't we do a target-based, just like we do for LEAP, just like we do for other social interventions. See, the issue is that we are trying to bridge the gap between the rich and the poor by using education. And so what we do is to try as much as possible to do target-based. And to target the very people who really need the support and provide the funding for them. And if we were to do that, then we are likely to provide absolutely, completely free senior high school for the very needy people in society. But if we throw the money out there to everyone, then we are not likely to meet the target. The government can simply not be able to pay every single fee component in the student bill. But let me also add that we are doing this in at the backdrop of restoration of teacher training allowance. And that alone will be increasing or ballooning our budget by some 7.5 million Ghana cedis every single month, or 90 million Ghana cedis every single month, if we were to admit 15,000 students in the 2017-2018 academic year. And to pay them roughly 450 Ghana cedis a month as teacher training allowance. So we have to look at all these issues and see how best we can address our secondary school system and to ensure that there's equitable access to good quality senior high school.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Prince. I'm Executive Director for the Institute of Education, IFEST, and I hope that we can also speak to you later on another regular programming on the subject. But he made a valid point, I think you also made, because you had said you don't know whether you were making commentary whether it should be graduated or perhaps old. And he thought that perhaps if we did the targeting, that would be, because you also said there were people who could pay.
Yes. I mean, I think the idea of the scholarship
is it going to be a scholarship or is just almost like a scholarship?
Well, I mean, that's what he said. And I'm trying to process what he meant by that. I think that if that is the case, then one would then have to make sure that there is a process in place that it's fair, it's transparent, and that there's no fraud in terms of people unduly using influences from, let's say, a party or whatever to get the scholarship. Uh-huh. So I think that is part of the issue. And I believe that the average person who can afford it and doesn't want to go through the process of going through the scholarship process would then just pay for their child. So yes, it might be a good valve to get people in and out of the system whereby those who need it go ahead and get it done. One would also then have to wonder if the parents would be would have the wherewithal to even do that, because if, let's say, an illiterate parent has to apply for a scholarship, how do they do that? And then how does some sort of, you know, a carpetbagger, con man come and tell them that I want to apply for you and here's the fees, this is my 50 Ghana cedis for you to me to assure you something, and then the child gets nothing. So those are all sort of things that one has to worry about with the scholarship system. But I think, yes, some people don't need it. And typically, the ones who don't need it will not even look for it. Uh-huh. And the question is the gray area between those who would like to have some assistance and those who would not. I don't know how to argue against parental participation. I think a parent needs to be involved in a child's education. But if the parents are not, that doesn't mean the child should also suffer. So that's where also, I believe that the economy needs educated citizens. So it makes sense to educate everybody. The problem I envision that, I'm assuming that he's also seeing the same thing, is that the BECE stops people from going forward. But at the same time, when you allow them to go forward, you have to make sure that when they get to the end, they become well-educated, not just passing them through. Because then you would have wasted a lot of money.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So I believe that, and nobody would argue that quality needs to be the issue. And I think that the distinction between assessing children and putting a performance noose around their neck is where that fine line needs to be appreciated. Because you don't want the child to go through and you get to the end and you realize the child hasn't learned anything. So we need to have dynamic formative assessment as the child goes through their academic education.
Well, thank you. And thanks for joining us for the conversation. We've enjoyed it. We hope that we can bring you back so that we can also, after the policy or government people have talked on the subject very well and tried to do the explanation as to what the president meant by what he said over the weekend, then we can put a lot more meat onto the bone as it is. But let's also pick your thoughts on Facebook before we go off. We have Kujo Evans, bravo Nana, it's a bold step. Go ahead and implement many more good policies to raise Ghana. Don't take criticism that are not passionate. We also have Mark Felix, Kwame Adibu. I'm happy the government is fulfilling its promise of a free high school. I wish government well and pray that with the help of God, Ghanaians would be proud. They'll be made proud by government, so to speak. Nana Owusu Berima, I will insist that Ghana is not rich enough for such policy or such a policy. Doom saw unemployment, water crisis, and others must be solved before free SHS could be done. Shivan Samlai, you need free education across the board, especially pre K, etc. I'm sure you're trying to say preschool or kindergarten thereabout. Leonard Grant, I hope someone with a little intelligence will ask him how and where he's going to get the funds from without raising taxes and tariffs. Sokohene Ansar Sante, we go chop free education to sleep. Must I try and bring money to the economy and stop what you're doing? Festivity about Summer Wilson. And I said, amen, because we, the graduate unemployed, the unemployed graduates still have hope. Our time will come soon. So we have a couple of your messages on Facebook. You just have to get onto our Facebook page. We've posed a question there on the subject of the free education policy as better explained or perhaps announced by the president. The president is saying that the next academic year, that's the beginning of the next academic year, we'll see the full on the implementation of the free SHS policy. And just like captured by the news media, including our own, and let me just read a text from the Daily Graphic. It says, by free SHS, we mean that in addition to tuition, which is already free, there will be no admission fees, no library fees, no science center fees, no computer lab fees, no utility fees. There will be free textbooks, free boarding, and free meals, and these students will get a meal at school for free. That's a good initiative. Well, it has to be implemented well, too. But let's look at this. And we've had in the studio from the United Network for Integrated Development Planning and Management, UNIDPM, its Executive Director, Eke Mamonu-Latson. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
And we'll have you again sometime.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.